All right. So today we are talking about the management of orthostatic intolerance. And when we talk about the management, I think it's helpful for us to say, what are we actually trying to do here? What are our parameters by which we measure improvement? What at a base level are we physiologically trying to accomplish? So essentially, we want to improve perfusion for people. We want to do that by expanding their overall blood volume. We want to constrict blood vessels in the right places at the right times. We want to improve exceedingly rapid heart rates. And we really want to modulate the autonomic nervous system to work to our advantage, not our disadvantage. So first and foremost, when we're assessing orthostatic intolerance, we want to recognize and avoid common triggers to the degree that they can be avoided. So heat in particular, like the heat we had here in Utah last weekend, going out in the middle of the day in one of those circumstances with orthostatic intolerance would be inadvisable. Dehydration coming from heat can play a huge role. Prolonged standing in place or prolonged standing or sitting with your feet on the floor can exacerbate orthostatic intolerance as compared to being in a reclined position, having one's legs elevated or laying down. Prolonged bed rest, of course, can confuse the autonomic nervous system. We see this not uncommonly when people leave a prolonged stay in the ICU, for example, but also in some of our post-viral or post-infectious illness patients, we can see this after prolonged bed rest or a long crash of post-exertional malaise where they barely spent any time out of bed for multiple days, weeks on end. Muscle atrophy and muscle weakness, particularly core weakness or weakness in the upper or lower legs, can contribute to orthostatic intolerance. And of course, like many things in life, medications are things we have to think about that can exacerbate or worsen orthostatic intolerance. So we always want to be cognizant of these things before we embark on a more dedicated treatment regimen. So how do we increase intravascular volume? Well, it's one thing to increase free water, but we want to do so in combination with or in balance with increasing sodium intake. If we increase free water, but we don't do anything with sodium, our very well-programmed kidneys will reduce that water level back to maintain homeostasis between fluid and salt. If we add a bunch of salt, but we don't increase free water, the kidney will start holding on to water, will match that fluid, and then it will reduce the overall volume. So when we're trying to increase intravascular volume so that there is more blood flow to get to all the places it needs to get to, we want to add fluid and sodium in somewhat equivalent ratios so that we can sort of trick the kidney into giving the physiology that we really want for our patients in this case. So how do we do that? Well, there's a lot of different ways. And one of the things I will do with my sickest patients is to try IV normal saline infusions, because normal saline really is a great way to sort of get a balanced fluid and salt on board, especially in people who are particularly sick and who may not be able to initially take it in orally due to all of their dysautonomia. So a lot of times, even a trial of IV normal saline for a few days in a row, I'll give a liter or a liter and a half, 3-4 days in a row, can be a diagnostic measure to really help you in a complicated multi-system illness patient to determine exactly how much of their symptoms and what of their symptoms are being driven by orthostatic intolerance. Do they have small fiber polyneuropathy that's being worsened by poor peripheral blood flow as a result of orthostatic intolerance? Do they have GI motility issues related to poor GI blood flow or appropriate GI blood flow when the signals for peristalsis are being sent? Sometimes a diagnostic trial of IV normal saline can be very helpful in elucidating just how much orthostatic intolerance is contributing to people's overall symptom presentation. But it can also be therapeutic. And a lot of times I will bridge with IV normal saline for several weeks on end, occasionally through a PICC line, sometimes through peripheral IVs when vascular access isn't as difficult. I may give fluids 3 times a week, keep an IV in place Monday through Friday, remove it and let everything get cleaned up on a Saturday and Sunday before restarting again. And when I say bridging, I mean bridging to some of the other pharmacotherapies that will be additive or synergistic to increasing volume, and we're going to get to those in a moment. It may also bridge to better oral tolerance of medications in general or of oral intake of fluid and sodium, because that can be really difficult when dysautonomia is out of control and orthostatic intolerance is out of control at the very beginning of implementing treatment. So sometimes this can bridge to improved GI function so that you can get people taking oral meds and then remove the IV fluids. You hear that oral free water and sodium intake is going to be a key component of all of this. And without doing so, a lot of our other pharmacotherapies are going to be very blunted or not as impactful without the volume to circulate in the first place. So while it is different based on how large or small your individual is, we try to take a one-size-fits-all approach to say if you're in this range, you're at least getting a good start. And that range tends to be 80 to 100 ounces of free water daily. And I aim for 1500 to 2000 milligrams of sodium added to this amount of free water. I always tell my patients, you know, eating a lot of potato chips, salting your food, going to McDonald's, that's all gravy. That's all frosting on the cake, but that does not count as your intake of sodium per day. And it's because it seems to be so inconsistent in how it's absorbed and how it's put into the diet that I more or less require of my patients that they use some kind of buffered salt tablet or oral rehydration solution to get their sodium in. And I tell them, this is like a prescription. This is a medicine that you need to take and you need to be consistent with it every single day. So there's a lot of options when it comes to oral rehydration solutions, and different patients will have different favorites, but some of the ones that have been really helpful for our patient population include liquid IV, which you can see there on the right. That's very omnipresent at a lot of grocery stores. I've even heard ads for it on some of the podcasts I listen to. It's present in Target and all the drugstores. It does have added sugar to it, which may help in the absorption, but when people use it really heavily over time, occasionally it can exacerbate diarrhea or it can lead to weight gain. Another option is Normalite, and there are several flavors, but I recommend the Pure here that we see in the bottom left. That has no artificial sweeteners, colors, dyes, or preservatives, and no added sugar, so it should not contribute to weight gain. It does taste a little salty to people, and it's not as preferred from a taste perspective as something like liquid IV, but people start to feel that they associate that salty flavor with feeling better. And it's not, I actually drink this myself. I have underlying POTS without post-exertional malaise, and I find that it's not terribly offensive. I could never gargle with salt water when I was younger, but this is nowhere near that salty. It's much more buffered. And more of a subtle taste there. Noon Sport is really something that's been aimed at athletes, people who cycle for long periods of time, ultra runners, triathletes, but can be really helpful and have some flavor as well for people, but maybe not as much sugar or difficulty with tolerance as liquid IV, though the price is much higher. I also very much recommend this salt stick by Tassium that you can see here. These are buffered electrolyte salts. They come in capsules. They are much less irritating to the GI system than, say, our traditional nephrology type of salt tablets. And so you can take these with just a tiny bit of fluid and usually have a GI tolerance for them. So if people want to drink free water only and they can't stand the taste of one of these oral rehydration solutions, this is another option there that is generally well tolerated. Trioral is another oral rehydration salt that helps. There is a World Health Organization rehydration formula that was originally developed to help people in endemic areas with dysentery and cholera. That can actually be made on the cheap at home following a recipe. And then actually even simple original V8, having cans of that around can be a good rescue for people who kind of like that flavor as well. So these are all options or ways to get people who are not so sure that they can get fluid and salt in to start increasing that oral fluid and salt intake. So getting that in is really the first step. We've now increased the intravascular volume to some degree, but what do we do with that from here on out? Well, we already know that people with dysautonomia and orthostatic intolerance and post-viral or post-infectious illnesses are going to have increased pooling on the average in the lower extremities and in the splanchnic veins during orthostasis. So in other words, you get all this venous pooling that is dependent with the effect of gravity on the veins when you're in an upright position, when your legs are on the floor. And that fluid can pool just in those veins, and it can also third space out into the connective tissues there. So you've got all that volume, but now you need it to remain intravascular. And that's where compression clothing really comes in. It can help push that third spacing volume back into the veins and even act as an assistance to your skeletal muscle to improve venous return in the cardiovascular system, something that we know is not always optimized in these conditions. So compression clothing is a huge tool in that regard and not to be missed. So right here, we actually have a study that was done at Vanderbilt University at their autonomic dysfunction center, where they looked at four different groups of patients, patients who had no compression, patients who were using leg compression to below the knees, people who used above the knee compression only, so including their abdomen up to their rib cage and all the way down to just superior of their knees, and then what we call full compression, which involves all of the above. And those patients were looked at in a heads up tilt table test. And here what you can see is that as the tilt is trying to induce orthostatic intolerance in these patients, you can see what's going on with their heart rate and their systolic blood pressure. And as patients have no compression, you can see that they have massive increases in their heart rate, and they see decreases in their systolic blood pressure. And as we add leg compression, that is mitigated slightly, both with blood pressure and with heart rate increase. If you look at those with the abdominal compression, they actually have a greater response than those with leg compression below the knees, as far as reducing heart rate and reducing changes in the systolic blood pressure. And if you put people in full surface area compression, they have the least amount of change in heart rate and in systolic blood pressure. On that tilt table, they also asked patients to fill out a Vanderbilt orthostatic symptom score, which is another way of assessing orthostatic intolerance from a symptomatic perspective. This is a validated measure. And you can see that the symptoms actually correlate with degree of compression as well. So full compression is superior. Abdominal compression is better than leg compression, which is better than no compression as far as reducing overall orthostatic intolerance scores. So there's a correlation both with vital signs and with what patients are symptomatically feeling with compression. So there have been arguments that even if you have a patient who has significant hyperalgesia, for example, in the lower extremities and can't tolerate compression socks, traditional compression socks alone, abdominal compression, even in the absence of lower extremity compression, may provide significant clinical benefit for those people. So certainly, really push to try to get whatever degree of surface area of abdominal compression you can, because it can make an enormous difference for patients. And this is actually something, this is data from one of our patients at the Bateman Horne Center, who actually, this is her own version of a standing passive lean test or a NASA lean test at her own home that she measured on her own using a pulse ox and a blood pressure cuff. And she was actually on several pharmacotherapies, but despite those pharmacotherapies, you can see that her baseline heart rate increased from 60 beats per minute up to 134 at 5 minutes standing, despite these influences of pharmacotherapy. And you can see also that her blood pressure decreased from 112 over 72 all the way down to 79 over 63. So definite orthostatic hypotension as well. The only change she then made was that she went to the Under Armour store, got a bunch of compression clothing, and wrapped herself up like a mummy. And you can see now that her heart rate baseline was just slightly lower, but she only increased to 89 beats per minute as opposed to 134 beats per minute. And her blood pressure was maintained and did not drop out and show orthostatic hypotension. This is with compression alone. So I want people to be really cognizant of this and to keep working and keep pushing their patients to use compression when you have the appropriate intravascular volume, because it can make a world of difference in their function, their symptom scores, and in their vital signs. Before we go on to fludrocortisone, I would also say that it is, in my opinion, it's more important to get or increase the overall surface area or volume, surface area volume of compression as compared to how much compression in millimeters of mercury you're using. You can use 40 millimeters of mercury of compression below the knees, and maybe you're pushing some of that third spacing fluid or that venous fluid back up into the thighs, but you're not necessarily guaranteeing it's going to participate in circulation. So it's not so much about how intense the compression is, so much as how much surface area you're really covering. And with that in mind, I often encourage my patients to use athletic wear, which tends to be more comfortable, more breathable, more accessible than things designed by physicians to really increase their compliance with compression. And it tends to be much better tolerated, but also more likely that they're going to continue using it or that they can slip it under their normal clothing. I could be hiding it under my clothing right now and nobody would know during this presentation. So it has advantages in that way as well.
Dr. Yellman, there's a question on any recommendations on compression clothing brands.
Really, it's about what fits any individual in particular. But I always tend to refer to sports clothing as compared to sort of medical device based compression clothing. And I know certain people have found good things in the medical device realm as well. But I think on the average, sports clothing, yoga clothing is much better tolerated. So now that we have improved free water and sodium, we've improved intravascular volume, perhaps we are now using compression to maintain that volume in the intravascular space. What other things need to be done to prevent the kidney from saying, hey, this is still more volume than I think we need to be euvolemic? Well, we use fludrocortisone in that regard. This is a potent mineralocorticoid, which is different than a corticosteroid like prednisone or methylprednisolone, et cetera. And it is very similar in its effect to that of aldosterone. So what it's really doing is it's going to the kidney and promoting resorption of sodium and loss of potassium from the distal renal tubules. So essentially what we're doing is we're sort of tricking the kidney to reset what a definition of euvolemia is, so that you will hold on to this excess volume or intravascular volume through fluid and salt for a little bit longer so that it can participate in circulation longer and improve overall orthostatic intolerance. So this is not nearly as potent if I gave somebody fludrocortisone, but they weren't fluid and volume loading either orally or through IV fluids, right? If you don't have volume to maintain, then the kidney has nothing to hold on to. So it's not going to be effective without first repleting intravascular volume. Common side effects you might see with fludrocortisone could be headaches, and they tend to be more often in supine position than in upright position. But really, I guess it can be a little activating in some people. It can feel like a little boost of caffeine or a little boost of energy, which can be good in some cases or irritating in other cases, depending on the patient who you are treating. And fludrocortisone, as we talked about earlier, is not going to increase your risk for immune suppression and getting infections. It's not increasing your overall hemoglobin A1C. It's not going to lead to all of the side effects that we experience with corticosteroids in any significant way, nor is it going to be a problem if someone's going to go in for, say, bunion removal surgery or a small elective procedure, that they would have to remain off of this for several weeks or months so that they don't have adrenal insufficiency. We have not run into problems with this in our patients. Another pharmacotherapy that can be really helpful is midodrine. So midodrine is a drug that forms a metabolite called desglymidodrine. And this is an alpha-1 agonist that is going to increase constriction and tone in arterioles and in veins. So you will see an increase in systolic and diastolic pressures, particularly in upright positions when you use midodrine. And it is particularly potent as a drug in the splanchnic vasculature compared to the periphery. So we essentially see almost a shunting side effect where you get, instead of having significant vasodilation in the periphery, say an exposure to heat or a hot shower when someone might get flushed and be racing blood to the to the surface so that you can participate in evaporative cooling. By using something like midodrine and clamping down on those peripheral vessels, you are keeping that blood shunted back to muscles, to the cardiovascular system, and even to cerebral blood flow. And this is where it really seems to have its benefit for patients. This med does diffuse poorly across the blood-brain barrier and has very few central nervous system effects. And I really think about employing this in those who experience a lot of facial flushing, who experience a sensation of rapid temperature changes, going from really hot to really cold, whether or not that is induced by their environment or it's completely their own autonomic nervous system. Both cases, it seems to be effective. When people notice trouble standing in one position, like standing in a line, standing at the kitchen sink to do dishes, standing in one place in a shower, or even having difficulty showering, midodrine can be a really great choice in those cases. Side effects you need to watch out for with midodrine is supine hypertension. So we don't ask patients to take midodrine, say, before they go to sleep. We think about it often with midodrine, but I really don't feel like I see it all that much clinically. So keep it in mind, but you know, if you have a particularly hypertensive patient, this is not a great first-line therapy. But otherwise, I don't find it to be as common as it might appear in the literature. More common, however, are a lot of what we like to refer to as pseudoneurological sensory side effects. So as you shunt blood away from some of the sensory nerves in the periphery, people can get some sort of confused sensory signals. There's sensations of scalp tingling, of goosebumps on the scalp. I've had people say, hey, my scalp feels wet, but it's actually dry. They may feel like their skin is a little sensitive, like they're being tickled by a feather or an ant is crawling on them, or even a slight sensation of itchiness. Generally, when these symptoms are not severe, we tell patients to stick with it. And within a few days to a week, those often get quite a bit better as the body adjusts to sort of slightly altered physiology in this case. So don't have people give up the second they feel the slightest of side effects. This benefit continues to grow over time, and those side effects tend to be reduced over time. I saved a little more time for use of the drug pyridostigmine, which is a very off-label use, but has been a major tool in our arsenal for combating orthostatic intolerance and dysautonomia in general. And I feel it bears taking a little time to remind everybody what pyridostigmine really is. This was a drug that was developed initially for management of myasthenia gravis. And what it does is it inhibits the acetylcholine esterase, the enzyme that will more or less degrade your acetylcholine in the neuromuscular junction synaptic cleft. So we actually use this in myasthenia gravis. What's happening is you're blocking the reuptake of acetylcholine into the nerve ending so it can be released again and initiate a contraction at the neuromuscular junction. So when that acetylcholine runs out, people can no longer maintain contractions at their muscles. And that's because that acetylcholine in the synaptic cleft is getting degraded. Well, when you block the enzyme that's doing so, even though the acetylcholine can't necessarily participate in reuptake in the nerve ending, it's still present so that it can continue to bind with acetylcholine receptors on that postganglionic muscle so that you can maintain a contraction there. So why do we use it though in orthostatic intolerance? What are we getting out of this with off-label use? Well, it does by its effect on acetylcholine esterase increase or enhance cholinergic stimulation at other places in the body, particularly in other aspects of the autonomic nervous system. And here what we have is a representation of a sympathetic nervous system pathway. So we have our preganglionic sympathetic neuron, here is our sympathetic ganglion, and then here is a sympathetic terminal. And what you see is that the preganglionic neurons do release acetylcholine. So we have an enhanced release of acetylcholine through pyridostigmine by blocking that acetylcholine esterase receptor, which acts on these sympathetic ganglions to actually increase norepinephrine release from that sympathetic terminal. And so that norepinephrine can go and act on an alpha-1 receptor on blood vessels in the same place that midodrine would act to increase vascular tone. and actually promote improved vascular tone. And here, just for a complete representation, here's fludrocortisone increasing our volume expansion. Here's midodrine acting on the alpha-1 receptors to actually shunt that volume to where it needs to go most. And then here is pyridostigmine increasing norepinephrine transmission from the sympathetic terminal to enhance what's going on at that alpha-1 receptor and improve our venoconstriction in particular, even more than arterial constriction in the vascular tree. So ultimately, what we're hoping this does is it leads to improvement of blood flow return to the heart and increased preload filling of the heart, which are very well-documented problems in post-infectious illnesses. And that's actually been confirmed by studies at Brigham and Women's invasive cardiopulmonary studies and catheter right heart catheterization studies. And then this has been proven to actually improve venous return in those studies as well using pyridostigmine off-label. That data is not all published yet, but will be published soon in the future. So interestingly, as I was alluding to, non-invasive measurements of exercise capacity, such as O2 intake, end-tidal CO2, and ventilatory efficiency, all improve in research studies with the use of pyridostigmine. And there is this phase 2 trial nearing completion in which invasive hemodynamic measurements, including peak oxygen uptake via VO2 max and skeletal muscle oxygen extraction, are being measured and seen to improve with use of pyridostigmine. So there are other mechanisms by which pyridostigmine may also be helpful in these patients. Not only is it improving venoconstriction and venous preload return with all the volume that you've added, but we get reversal of arteriovenous shunting that can be part of the dysautonomia that exists when a small fiber polyneuropathy is present. So small fiber polyneuropathy can lead to loss of myovascular innervation, which results in abnormal vessel patency, and you get blood flow directly from arteries to the veins, bypassing the capillaries and that ability to exchange oxygen and nutrients and remove metabolic waste products. And that lack of delivery of nutrients and removal of metabolic waste products, as you can imagine, can really lead to cellular exhaustion of energy and inadequate function of those cells, be they muscle cells, be they nerve cells, et cetera. So by using pyridostigmine, we have actually seen documented reversal in this AV shunting and opening again of the capillaries so that you can get appropriate exchange of nutrients, oxygen, and removal of metabolic waste products. What are some of the side effects of pyridostigmine? We'll go back to thinking about how this medication works. It's increasing acetylcholine. Not only is there acetylcholine used in the sympathetic nervous system, but acetylcholine is the primary neurotransmitter of the parasympathetic nervous system, known as the rest and digest nervous system. If you're increasing parasympathetic signaling, that may increase signals for peristalsis, which can sometimes be interpreted as GI cramping or increased loose stool output or diarrhea for patients. Another thing is when you flood the neuromuscular junction with acetylcholine, you can get increases in muscle fasciculations. These do not tend to be painful or dangerous. They very much are similar to if you've ever had your eyelid flutter on its own. It's certainly a strange feeling, and it's not something you're consciously doing, and it can be particularly disturbing if it's happening in your thigh, but it's actually not dangerous. And so we just warn patients to pay attention to this, and that might be a slightly too high of a dose if that's occurring at a high rate or for prolonged periods of time. And then, of course, acetylcholine can be part of increasing overall secretion. So sweating, salivation, and tearing as well. If those become excessive, it could be that the pyridostigmine dose used is a little bit too high for patients. And I would say to think about these things as all synergistic, right? You know, 1 + 1 + 1 does not equal 3 in this case. It equals 4 or 5. So when you improve intravascular volume via fluid and salt and make sure it stays in the spaces it needs to using compression clothing, maybe giving arterial constriction through midodrine, you now have all of the substrate you need in the places it needs to be. And then if you add pyridostigmine, it's almost like adding a motor to help that circulate better. So these things are all going to enhance one another rather than trying them singly and separately and saying, oh, I tried midodrine, it didn't work. Oh, I'm trying pyridostigmine, it didn't work. Oh, I tried fludrocortisone and it didn't work. These things, you don't necessarily want to start them all at the exact same time, but you want to give patients a chance to utilize them in conjunction to maximize their potential for benefit here. One question that often comes up is, what is the value of beta blockers, right? That's what we tend to think of most traditionally, and at least in patients who carry the diagnosis of POTS as their descriptor for their orthostatic intolerance. And I want to remind people what we're actually doing with beta blockers. We are trying to reduce sympathetic overactivation, and we're trying to maximize cardiac output. So I really don't see these as first line in most cases of orthostatic intolerance, though there are utilities for this from time to time. So we really want to block the adrenergic subtype receptors, beta 1 and beta 2. Remember that beta 1 receptors are primarily present in cardiac tissues, and they mediate contractility and heart rate, whereas beta 2 receptors are located in the smooth muscles of blood vessels, but also, as we know from our asthma patients, in the bronchial tree. So we tend to lean towards second generation beta blockers like atenolol and bisoprolol that have a higher affinity for beta 1 receptors and are more cardioselective on the average, but not as, as an absolute rule. I would say definitely avoid all third generation beta blockers if you're going to use them. Things like carvedilol, labetalol, and nivolumab, because these also have alpha adrenergic and nitric oxide influences that can cause vasodilation. So me, in my clinical practice, most frequently I will use atenolol, metoprolol, or propranolol. And when I'm choosing what I want to use, I consider the duration of action. Do I need something at baseline that's going to give me 12-hour coverage or 24-hour coverage? Do I want to just use it as needed in specific situations? Do I want to take it scheduled or as needed? These are kind of the things I think about when choosing a specific agent. Common side effects, as we all know with beta blockers, include fatigue, lightheadedness and dizziness, bradycardia, and in some cases, asthma exacerbation, although I think this is really rare in our orthostatic intolerance patients. Even when they have a history of asthma, it tends to be more mast cell mediated than IgE mediated, and I do not see the significant worsening of asthma very often when I use beta blockers in this patient population in particular. So I like this. You may have seen me use this before. I feel like this is the patient experience. Often you come in, you have all these symptoms, and they say, yeah, you know, everything's perfectly normal. I wouldn't worry about all those stripes, though. That's, you know, we see that sometimes. Just make sure you have a good diet and exercise, and you'll be feeling better. So that's my way of saying, well, what about exercise, right? Isn't exercise good for orthostatic intolerance? Doesn't that help us increase cardiac output and improve cardiovascular tone? Certainly physiological decompensation, as we talked about from supine positioning, unquestionably worsens orthostatic intolerance symptoms. Sitting around, not getting up, having no energy to do so, being ill can make these things worse. So of course, cardiovascular training can improve cardiac output via an improved stroke volume as you train, and by improving vascular tone to support optimal blood flow to the muscles. This is really the idea behind graded exercise therapy in postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome and other dysautonomias. So why wouldn't we tell our patients, just exercise more, you'll feel better? And to that I say, not so fast, right? It really depends on the situation. Exercise can be a primary trigger for post-exertional malaise, as we've talked about in the past, in those who are suffering from ME/CFS, long COVID or post-acute sequelae of COVID, or who meet any other definition of post-infectious illness, right? So if there is a component of post-exertional malaise, as we've talked about in the past, before you even try to treat other aspects of their illness, including orthostatic intolerance, you have to help keep people out of post-exertional malaise. And this is the reason that we've come out so strongly in the ME/CFS world against graded exercise therapy, because it will continue to push people into post-exertional malaise, a reduced physiological state where they cannot generate energy and they're never going to see the gains from exercise that otherwise healthy people or even people with dysautonomia who do not have post-exertional malaise can experience. Does that mean no exercise at all? No, it doesn't. So we always say exercise is still good for patients so long as they can tolerate it without triggering post-exertional malaise. And that can be tricky, and that can be a journey that you take with your patients. So preferable initial exercise therapies include things that are supine in nature, right? If you do them on your back, that's a lot better than doing them upright. We like to start with core strengthening exercises. Sometimes water or pool-based exercises take a lot of the weight off of it, much like we would use these in patients with severe knee osteoarthritis, for example, and obesity. We also find that sort of reducing the overall effect of gravity by using pool exercises can be really helpful to get people moving again. And of course, water and pool-based exercises, if your patient has a complicated amplified pain syndrome, a fibromyalgia, small fiber polyneuropathy, these have also been proven in randomized clinical trials to improve management of those types of pain. Isometric exercises will always be preferable to aerobic exercises. So I tell people, for example, if you're laying back on a leg press machine instead of doing 10 reps, you're better doing an equivalent of a wall sit and holding it for 30 seconds than you are doing 10 reps, as far as eventually increasing your capacity for exercise, but also not triggering post-exertional malaise. And then yoga and Pilates can be really helpful, particularly in a supine or reclined position. And what I like to tell my patients to do is to consider monitoring their heart rate with a wearable device when they are doing exercise. Some of these wearable devices, you can even set an alarm for a specific heart rate. And it's going to be different for different patients, but somewhere in the 90 to 110 heart rate range. And when the alarm goes off, what it is it's meant to be biofeedback to the patient to say that when your heart rate is increasing, this may be a surrogate marker for the fact that your body is now under physiological stress with this exercise. And so what I want people to do then is when they get to that certain heart rate that they know could be challenging for them or that could trigger post-exertional malaise, to stop doing what they're doing and rest and wait as long as it takes until that heart rate comes back down to their baseline pre-exercise heart rate, then resume the exercise you were doing. So sometimes people will find it takes an hour to do 15 minutes of active exercise, but by not pushing through these heart rate elevations, they find that they don't experience PEM the following day, and they still can gradually and slowly improve their overall cardiac output and cardiovascular tone and increase their exercise capacity over time. The other thing this does is it helps capture physiological differences from day to day. You know, one day somebody might be able to do the leg press for 30 seconds, and then you know, a few days later after some rest, they can only do it for 10 seconds. And they're not sure why there's a difference there, but at least their heart rate is telling them, hey, you're struggling with this more today. Maybe they didn't sleep well the night before. Maybe they're close to going into post-exertional malaise. Maybe they've been recently exposed to COVID-19 and their immune system is on alert. There's a lot of things that they can't always detect, but the heart rate will often say, hey, you're under physiological stress. And it's a tool to help them know when to stop and rest on that specific day. So with those things in mind, I wanted to return back to a patient here. This was a 21-year-old male who had been diagnosed with ME/CFS and with postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome in high school. He was a competitive athlete, but he became ill in his senior year of high school. That was 4 years ago, and he continued to lose functional capacity and experience more and more severe symptoms. And this is despite spending 2 years with a POTS specialist. He was saying that he struggled to perform any daily activities. He couldn't shower, he couldn't eat, he couldn't walk up the stairs, struggled to walk, sit, and stand without falling over. He felt his muscles were too weak to hold himself up, and his brain fog and cognitive function was too great to have any sense of what was going on in his surroundings. And here you can see a NASA lean test or a passive standing lean test that he had done in our office. His pulse started at 54 and very easily went up to 105. And you can see there in his blood pressures that as the 10 minutes passed, he lost systolic blood pressure and tone and actually increased his diastolic pressure at first there until everything really started dropping out at the 7 to 8 minute mark and he became orthostatically hypotensive. So very symptomatic on a passive standing lean test. Noted a lot of symptoms of feeling like he was going to pass out, difficulty breathing, shortness of breath, and dizziness during that test. However, we got him on a regimen of aggressive oral free water intake with 1,000 milligrams of sodium supplementation per day. He got compression leggings alone. He was not even using abdominal compression. And he started very low dose pyridostigmine at 30 milligrams. They come in 60 milligram tablets. And he was doing this in the morning and then 4 hours after that, prior to his testing. And you can see here the differences we see as reflected in his vital signs during this passive standing lean test. So his heart rate did not increase nearly to the same degree. It more or less stayed in the 60 to 70 range. And you do not see the blood pressure dropout that he had prior to treatment. So these type of interventions can be followed both from a how is the patient functioning perspective, how are their symptoms, being reported, but you can also repeat passive standing lean tests to look for changes pre and post intervention. We don't always do that, but if you have questions or you're not quite sure, it's a really good tool you can always turn to. So with that, I want to again just put up this page with resources here. Dysautonomia International has some resources on orthostatic intolerance and POTS. I would caution that they are not sure how to implement the passive standing lean test in their practices from a research perspective. Certainly we know from our experience that it's really helpful in the clinical perspective. Our BHC website or Bateman Horne Center website has a lot of educational videos on orthostatic intolerance. I would also encourage if you're interested to go to the patient section there where you can see several videos we have for supine yoga, for example, if you want to get your patients starting to work on their core strength or their exercise in a very slight way while you're working on managing their orthostatic intolerance. There are also provider resources there for orthostatic intolerance and other aspects of post-viral illnesses, long COVID and ME-CFS. And then of course, the Mayo Clinic Proceedings article that discusses management and evaluation of ME-CFS is often very applicable to our other post-viral illnesses and to long COVID as well.
Dr. Yellman, thank you. I think as we can see, OI management is both vitally important, no pun intended, but also, there's a lot to it. When we think about OI management, are there other considerations? And where I'm going with this is, what other comorbidities impact OI? You know, is mast cell something that, you know, needs to be considered when looking at OI management when certain pharmacological interventions have already been tried? What other things could be impacting that larger picture?
Well, I want to go back to our initial earlier slide that we mentioned. Think about things that could be exacerbating orthostatic intolerance. Our patients in a house that's air conditioning is not optimal on a 100 degree weekend. Are they taking SNRIs, which can exacerbate orthostatic intolerance, for example? Are they on diuretics for their, you know, spironolactone for their acne, or they're on diuretics for their quote unquote hypertensive response to a passive standing lean test? Definitely take a look at the medication regimen, even things like tamsulosin for BPH in our generally in our older males is something we want to take a look at and see if that can be contributing there. But yes, orthostatic intolerance does not exist in a vacuum. And when you talk about a complex multi-system illness, every other thing that's going on with their pathophysiology could be adversely impacting orthostatic intolerance. So if you're implementing some of these therapies and you're finding that you're not seeing the needle move, you might go back to the drawing board and some of the things that we'll be teaching in other lectures and say, could mast cell activation with abnormal activation of, you know, cells that release inflammatory cytokines that include histamine and leukotrienes and TNF-alpha and other interleukins, could that be exacerbating vasodilation and undercutting the work we're doing with orthostatic intolerance? Of course it could, right? So could decreased GI absorption from a malabsorption syndrome be contributing to a lack of really good absorption of fluid and salt so that you're not really increasing your intravascular volume as much as you thought you might be when you're trying to implement therapy for these patients? These are things you definitely have to think about, especially when you're hitting a roadblock. It looks like Dr. Bateman, you have some comments on that you'd like to share with us.
And we do have a question in the chat box I want to get to before we conclude.
Yeah, I was just going to remind us all that we're talking about chronic orthostatic intolerance and that acute dramatic orthostatic intolerance has a much bigger differential. And I remember when I was a resident, there was a guy who came in. This was in urgent care. I was moonlighting as a resident, and a guy came in urgent care and was very orthostatic and complaining of dizziness. And we did vitals and proved he was orthostatic, and I was getting ready to take a history. And then he vomited bright red blood all over me. You know, he was having this aggressive upper GI bleed. And the other interesting one I had when I was a resident was someone whose only presentation of his MI was orthostatic hypotension. He had a painless MI, and it took us a little while. So, you know, there's just keeping that in mind, right, when you're in an urgent care situation.
Yeah. Orthostatic intolerance as a manifestation of heart failure or impending heart failure. Yeah, so very much so. This is in our post-viral illness perspective, patients who have been chronically experiencing these symptoms that we're talking about all of this. It's a really good point. Thank you, Dr. Bateman.
Dr. Brown, would you say that you're seeing a significant difference with those who are, if you will, early onset? So in the, you know, long COVID patient population, are you seeing a lot of the OI in these individuals, the dysautonomia?
We do. I have to say, though, the different strains have been a little different. Like, I feel like Omicron was not nearly as bad in inducing that in comparison to like Alpha and Delta. You know, it's hard to know exactly why. You know, is it just a difference in the strain and its manifestation? Also, anosmia has not been nearly as much of a thing, you know, with the more recent strains. But, you know, I would say COVID is the gift that keeps giving because it keeps changing. And as far as that kind of management, the other thing is, I've used the John Hopkins free exercise resources as well, which is also like crossbody, reclining exercise as an option for people to do at home. And then keeping diaries of symptoms, like what did you eat today? How much caffeine did you take in? You know, all the things that, you know, people may not even be realizing that, you know, they're diuresing themselves because they're drinking a ton of caffeine or, you know, not taking in enough salt. And so I think helping patients sort of figure out their own combinations too, like, you know, write down if it was a good day or a bad day and look back at, you know, what was your heart rate with your exercise and were you exercising, and just helping them kind of sleuth out some of those patterns has been particularly helpful. So, and also empowering, I feel like, to patients, they don't sort of feel like they're just sort of stuck in the whirlwind. So, we're actually working to convert on a clinical trial to convert symptom management device, basically an app for tracking symptoms to convert. It used to be for cancer patients. We're actually working on seeing if we can convert that over and make it something really easy that like a long COVID patient could use.
And as you're alluding to, Dr. Mm-hmm. Brown, the margins in this can be really thin from functional to highly abnormal, right? So just mm-hmm. something as simple as a little less caffeine intake and a little less diuresis can really make a night and day difference in how a patient feels and functions.
Absolutely. The other quick plug before we disconnect, the American Association of PM&R came out with the long COVID cardiovascular complications guidance statement as well that just got published. So I put that in the chat for people to look at, but it like takes a really big step back and looks at all the potential, you know, things that have now been sort of described with post COVID. So something to think about, but like kind of getting into the heart failure issues, because obviously we've seen those, we've seen AFib, we've seen other, you know, severe complications. So again, you know, for those folks out there, it's like, you got to kind of keep a wide differential sometimes too.
Yeah, this is all really most applicable when you've ruled out acute causes, as mm-hmm. we said, and when you've ruled out that the patients have not had direct cardiovascular, cardiopulmonary toxicity from the acute infection itself.
Exactly.
So real quick, you guys kind of touched on this a little bit, but regarding caffeine intake, do you have recommendations that you typically give patients with OI? Can caffeine be helpful for symptoms in any situation, or should it be avoided?
I think it's really depends on the situation and the age and whether they're more hypertensive or tachycardic. Many factors come to play. I don't advise a lot of caffeine simply because it can increase pain and fibromyalgia and it can disturb sleep. But some people find it effective, you know, first thing in the day, but not in excess. So it really varies from person to person.
I understand there is a question. I agree with you, by the way, Dr. Bateman. There's a question about, is treatment different in these patients when they are hypertensive. The first question I would put to that question is, are they baseline hypertensive? And then what happens to their blood pressure with orthostatic challenge? Do they become more hypertensive? Do they have a hypertensive adaptive response to orthostatic intolerance or not? And when they have a hypertensive response to that physiological stress, I often find that you can find their blood pressure drop with appropriate treatment of orthostatic intolerance, but you certainly have to be very careful and just monitor things. You may do things in a slightly different order of operations. You may not start, for example, with something like midodrine, but you might look at fluid and salt as an initial, intervention there. Compression might be a good initial intervention there. And if you can sort of blunt that hypertensive response slightly with those initial interventions, you might feel more emboldened to use some of these other therapies as well.
Brayden, I was just going to throw this in. Can you see that, you guys? This is just an example of a lean test where the patient, it looks like the patient's getting hypertensive, right? The diastolic pressure comes up. That is to compensate, right? For that is the narrowing of the pulse pressure to compensate. But it's also kind of interesting that we gave her a dose of pyridostigmine and it really dramatically improved that, as well as improving her heart rate response. And that would be even better. Sometimes you can improve that hypertensive response simply with fluids and sodium. I've also made people hypertensive before with our interventions, and it's particularly true the older people get. So we just need to take into account their risk factors and their age.
One last thing that I think is worth mentioning that maybe I should have put into my slides. You'll find that in the cardiology world, in lieu of using beta blockers, they will often want to use Korlynor or ivermectin, which is works through sodium channels to slow the heart rate. And this is just a reminder that when we use or employ beta blockers, the primary goal is not necessarily to slow heart rate, right? We really want to reduce the physiological stress of what's going on with orthostatic symptomatology, with being upright as compared to laying down. And so by just blunting the heart rate alone, without thinking about what that heart rate is doing or responding to, or recognizing that that's an adaptive measure to increase cardiac output when the body's under physiological stress, we could be doing more harm than good. When we use our beta blockers, occasionally we'll do it if the heart rate is jumping up to, 150 with just standing up or going upstairs, right? Because at some point when you're going really, really fast, you have no time in diastole, you have no diastolic filling, your stroke volume falls. And then of course you're not getting good cardiac output. But really we think of it more from a blockade of sympathetic overdrive and this highly reactive response to outside stimuli, more than we do as a direct orthostatic intolerance treatment or mechanism. We'd like to see that heart rate response go down, not because we're blocking the heart rate, but because the body's not under so much physiological stress in the first place that it needs that secondary adaptive response. So I have just not had any luck in my patients with other drugs that slow heart rate, but that don't have that adrenergic blockade.
I was just going to add something to our discussion on orthostatic hypertensive response. If you want to know if your patient is hypertensive, you need to measure their blood pressure in a seated resting position, the way we measure all other blood pressures. So that's one of the best ways to judge. And also what their blood pressure is lying down, right? As opposed to that aggressive sympathetic response that occurs when people are being stressed by the orthostatic stressor. So I think that's what we do is we follow the seated, resting, feet on the floor, measure at the level of the heart. And then you can also compare the supine values to see if you're getting supine hypertension.
Thank you, guys. That was a really great session.